Look, it's Bernie Luck, Bernie Luck, videotaping us all and each and every one of us. Don't be on your best behavior. He's got a red light on there. He has that thing at you, he might just shoot you or something. You better watch that red light. Watch out!
Here come!
Red light on there!
I met Eddie Mack in 1978.
He was really like, I don't know, a guy you heard of, and then you met, like you thought he was more than he was, and then when you met him, he was like, Eddie Mack.
He's pretty incredible, a very unique character. We all are unique characters, but he would be one that really stood out.
I started working here in 1989, and the way that happened, Eddie Mack didn't realize that I was actually bartending. One day he brought a group of friends out to the Gristmill restaurant, and I was working out there and made them a whole bunch of shots, and he was like, I didn't know you were bartending. He says, you know, you've always got a place at Showdown if you need. And I said, well, thanks. And as fate would work out, I ended up starting in 1989 here and worked from 1989 to 2004.
Coming in here, it was like he really didn't want to hire me at first, but he kind of did on the back of my friend Mike Stiles. He put in a good word for me, but I worked at another bar and he heard bad things about that other bar, so really didn't want to hire me. But when I came in, he kind of like scooped me up and like took me under his wing, and I guess he saw the good in me and kind of like incubated me and made me into who I am.
He never met a person that like he couldn't relate to, you know. It wasn't just like, oh, you know, somebody's coming into my bar and I have to entertain them. He had this deep desire to connect, and he's, you know, he showed that here at the bar. He also showed that anywhere that we went. He always wanted to talk and always was, you know, super friendly, and that made a huge impression on people. He touched people in a way that they never forgot. I remember I went and worked at a ski resort in California, this tiny, tiny little town called Bear Valley, and I was sitting there and I was chatting with some people, and I told them, oh yeah, I'm from San Marcos, and they're like, have you ever been to the Showdown? And you kind of play along for a little bit. And you're like, well, yeah, I went to the Showdown. And they said, best Bloody Marys in town. I'm like, oh, yeah, I definitely agree. And they're like, did you know Eddie Mack? Yeah, I knew Eddie Mack.
I first got a job at Showdown. I was working there for probably a week before I met Eddie Mack. I was bar backing, and this old man walked in, walked straight behind the bar, and I looked at, you know, a bartender that had been there for a long time that had just been training me, and he didn't really seem to care that he was back there, so I, you know, disregarded him and continued to do my work, and eventually he was moving around, kind of in the way, and eventually he comes back over, and he hands me a flashlight, and he says, get down under there and tell me what you see, and he was pointing at the sink, and so I just immediately just was felt compelled to do what he asked me to. I got to the ground on my hands and knees, and behind a bar it was sticky and gross, and I'm shining a flashlight, and I don't even know what I'm looking for. And he says, what do you see? And I said, well, I see some pipes and you know, some drain lines, and nothing looks like it's fucked up or anything. And we stood back up, and he was like, all right, come with me. And we were about to go to the back, and I was just, you know, I just had to stop him. I was like, hey, man, you know, I'm Andrew Fox, by the way. I'm new here. And he's like, oh, I'm Eddie Mack. I'm your boss. Let's go.
My dad was probably the most gregarious person that I or many people in this bar had ever met. And I think he just never met somebody he thought of as a stranger. In his mind, a stranger was just a friend he hadn't made yet. I think it was because of that that he was really able to create and cultivate this community of folks that when we had his memorial some years back, we packed this place. I mean, you couldn't fit another soul in the Showdown. And we heard so many stories about him that both reinforced what we knew about him and who he was and added to it. It expanded what we thought our dad was to a place that we just hadn't really known before. I think he created this place in 77 when there wasn't a lot of community in San Marcos, and he really wanted a place where people could feel at home. I have this great picture of him where he's standing out on the street with Randy Holler, and he has the entire herd of Clydesdales from Budweiser, which they brought to him because they had had so much Budweiser. The patrons of this bar had consumed so much Budweiser that Budweiser had sent their Clydesdales to the streets of this little town to say thank you.
Eddie Mack and I started in Fort Worth, and from Fort Worth all the way to the Arlington Bar, was there for 3 years, and to San Marcos. We were the top sales for Budweiser and keg beer for the whole Texas.
And my dad is there, and he is just the epitome of a Texan hippie. So he has this giant head of curly hair.
Tell you what, that man had the best afro of any person I've ever seen. He was a white man. He had the coolest fro.
His fro looks fantastic. You know, he rocked the shit out of that.
And he has his mustache, he's got his pearl snap shirt, his giant belt buckle, then his Wrangler bell bottoms and his cowboy boots. And I think that that's what my dad really brought to this town, is he recognized that we all come from different places, we all have different parts of ourselves and different sort of dimensions of who we are, and he welcomed all of that. I think as you look around this bar, you see hippie, and you see country, and you see a little bit of yuppie, and maybe that's just me, and you see, you know, a little bit of everything, and he really believed that that's what made the Showdown what it was. You couldn't do this without all of that.
Well, and I think it's also very rare in this town that you find locals and college students coming together, and you find that here throughout the years, you know, where it's not... You know, so many of the bars in this town they're very separate. Like, oh, well, we're here to cater to the college crowd. But, like, Showdown brought them in college, and they never left. They just, like, they found their home. Like, it literally is a home.
Well, it's 40 below, and I don't give a fuck. Got a heater in my truck, and I'm off to the room.
We first moved here in 77 to open the Showdown up.
All right, come on, you fucking dummy, get your right step right. Get off stage, you goddamn goofy, no.
You piss me off, fucking jerk.
Tiger Contest, oh, we're the best.
Eddie Mack and I held that when we first opened the Showdown up here in San Marcos. It was a popular sport, chugging beers, and we went to chugging pitchers.
Then we'd have the redneckin', which is the Budweiser bottles, and two straws. You'd have a partner.
Eat!
The Showdown campouts were such a huge part of like what made this place like such an established family. You know, every year they would get together and they would bury a pig and they would have a 3-day celebration, and it was a chance for everybody to know that even though they were customers at the bar and like obviously like their money was important, but they were important as people as well. At the camp out, there was no charge for the camp out. The bar didn't benefit in any way, but the people did. Like, they realized, like, we're a part of this family. If you got an invitation to the camp out, like, you were part of the Showdown family.
his community focus extended so far beyond the Showdown. We were just reminiscing today about the parties that Showdown used to have, and my dad would get so much food. I think of his Mardi Gras party. So much food. I mean, these giant vats of red beans and rice and gumbo, and there was never enough people in San Marcos to eat all of it.
I did the shopping once, and I was appalled. Dad, this is way too much food. Like, what are you doing?
But he wouldn't stop, and he always had to have more than he needed, because there were two things my dad cared about. One, he was not going to run out of food. And two, he wanted to have enough left over that he could donate to the women's shelter of Hays County, because it was important to him to not only make his business successful, create a community within the walls of Showdown, but to support the community that was outside of that. And I think when I think about Dad's focus on community, it's creating and cultivating that community within the walls of Showdown, but also supporting and promoting that community outside of that.
They always had big parties. They had a Christmas party. They'd have a Halloween party. They had the party that they called Goodnight Irene Party, because that was actually Eddie Mack's favorite song. And so they had a party every year for that. They'd have an anniversary party for Showdown each year. And so all those were big, big events.
When we prep for a party, we come back here and say the Showdown campouts, we used to have them at what we call Little Arkansas. And you can't get to that property anymore. It's owned by Mr. Macias, the Mexican Budweiser King. But it used to be owned by O'Quinn and the McCoys before that. And so we had some connections that allowed us to get out there and camp out. And usually we camp out Friday, Saturday, and Sunday.
Okay, this is probably a flyer that Buddy Lurch did for Showdown in the late 70s, or after it opened. And when Showdown was actually a part of like five other bars. They were bars that were in college towns. TCU up in Fort Worth, University of Texas at Arlington, East Texas State, St. Commerce, Texas, and Southwest Texas in San Marcos. They had one in Austin over by UT. So there were like four or five different Showdowns, and they were always in college towns. But I think this might be the last one now. There might be one up in Fort Worth still, but the other ones are closed. One's in Austin. This is a real early flyer, and they made sandwiches. That was their big deal. They put out sandwiches. This flyer was probably an ad that was in the newspaper, a flyer that was worked up for the newspaper, you know, either the San Marcos paper or the university newspaper, or both. The later version, same thing, whether it's four different. They used to just have ham and cheese sandwich. That was pretty much it. They started offering more food. Toys for Tots was a big deal. Like they did the Christmas. That's actually a caricature of Eddie Mack.
He always did a toy drive every Christmas, and made sure the kids had toys, and they would set up a Christmas tree, and everybody would bring their toys in. I don't remember if this was through Showdown or through Devereaux's, where the mark is now. He owned a place with Randy Holler called Devereaux's, and they did Wheels Across America, which benefited disabled people, and it was a whole entire block party, and they had bands, and they shut down the square. That was a big part of it. The women's shelter, the toy drive.
I would say that my dad was generous almost to a fault. And he really preferred to focus his efforts in a hyper-local way. So I mentioned that at his memorial, we had people coming up to us and sharing stories about him that we had never known before. And many of them were stories about just that. I was so hard on my luck. I was so down. I didn't have a friend in the world. And your dad brought me out of that. I couldn't find a job anywhere. My own dad told me I didn't deserve a job, and your dad gave me a job. I had tried. I had these, hard experiences, and I just couldn't find a way to make it through, and your dad helped me out. And so I think, he was so he was community focused in a way that inspires me, and that he really wanted to make sure that his charitable dollars went where they were most needed. And I think you find where it's most needed sitting right there at that bar and talking to people and just hearing their stories and understanding where their needs are and how you might be able to help them. I think, you know, through the Showdown and through our childhood, he supported all kinds of community endeavors. The Playscape, he was an original supporter of the Playscape, our sports teams, our school efforts, you know, really our kind of childhood fundraising efforts. Eddie Mack and the Showdown were always a big part of it.
We felt like we were a family, you know, and which, you know, in turn, you got the memorial wall back there behind us. That there was a lot of people that have passed away that were and hung out and Showdown. They were family members, and we'll remember them as such. You know, the biggest picture on that wall is Eddie Mack, and deservedly so. Those parties, you know, everybody had their little own campsite in those parties, but there was also the common area where would go everybody to hang out, and Eddie might sometimes he'd sing to you. He couldn't really sing, but he'd try to sing to you.
Well, you know, Eddie Mack was. I told you, Eddie Mack's voice is a thing of its own, you know? So it's like talking, singing, snoring. It all sounded pretty much the same. So when he sang, it was all right. I mean, it was predictable. You know what you're going to get.
Well, I hear the train a-coming, and it's rolling around the bend. And I ain't seen the sunshine since I don't know when, because I'm stuck in Folsom Prison. And time keeps dragging on.
He would just have ladies drink for free on Wednesday nights, you know, free keg for the girls. That's how he would do ladies' night. Eventually, he would try to woo them even further by giving every girl that walked into a bar a rose whenever they walked into a bar. At one point, though, it was cracked down upon that ladies' night is not really legal, I think, according to TABC. There's a problem they have with offering a promotion or a discount to one group of people and not another, and you can't do that. And so I think everyone still has ladies' night. But Eddie Mack told me that, and he said, so we switched it to yellow night, and Showdown doesn't have a ladies' night anymore because that's illegal and we won't do it. But yellow night is, you know, where all ladies get their free drinks or discounted drinks, and any guy can too as long as he's wearing something yellow. And he liked yellow. You see a lot of yellow at the Showdown. And the reason why I liked yellow, for some reason, you know, he went to Yellowstone.
He realized there was a lot of yellow there, and he said that if 1 million people could visit this park in a year, why can't I paint the Showdown yellow and 1 million people visit us? And it's the stupidest thing I've ever heard. But that was him. That was his way of thinking, you know? He was always, like, thinking outside the box. It was like, you know what? If they could do this, we could do this too. We can bring this big thing to a small town. And he did that.
So the yellow started with, it was actually the sign. The sign and these kind of interior walls here, he painted yellow because he felt like yellow drew the most attention, and it worked. So his business, once he painted the sign and the interior walls here yellow, business increased by a lot. And my dad's, I think, less data-driven mind, but just anecdotally, he thought, this is working. I'm getting a lot of customers as a result of this. Yellow just became his thing. I have no idea where he found his yellow suit, but it became his thing.
Presidential chili here.
Here's shit with the spoon.
Hi there. This chili's so hot.
We think this chili is really good.
This chili's so hot.
We like it very much.
And I burned a hole in this spoon.
I was at a chili cook-off the other day, and his ex-wife, slash widow, I guess, was there. And the one thing she told me, she says, you know what? He was a terrible husband, but the greatest father you'd ever know. Because he loved those girls, and he would do anything in the world for them.
Any time that he had to talk about, like, free time, we had to talk about anything that wasn't other, that, like, wasn't business, was his daughters.
Back in the day, I think Showdown was pretty much a daycare. At the same time, there's the back part of Showdown that right now we use as a pseudo storage and a prep station, but it used to be a walk-around bar. And I've heard stories of customers that are there now drinking, telling me about when they would be in the back with the lights off, lying down, and it's just like three kids deep, you know, four kids wide, and everyone's just pillows and blankets, and it's like, all right, kids, time to take a nap, and everyone's on the other side of the building drinking at the Showdown. And it was friendly, kid friendly, so to say. There were kids at the Showdown. I think Ashley and Cassie were there a lot, and they were taken care of too. You know, it was a family. Showdown has been and always will be a community before it's a bar. First, it's a community. Showdown isn't an establishment. Showdown is a group of people. It just so happens we got a spot where we sell beer and liquor. And Eddie Mack is the firm foundation of that community. And even though it's owned by Dick Hartnett and John Hartnett, Eddie Mack, this was his creation, this Showdown. The way this is, the way this community has been together, you know, and Randy Holler gets that credit as well. He was there too. There was a bunch of them. I'm sure there's so many more that would love me to say their names. I don't know them. But without a doubt, Eddie Mack would have been a firm founder of this community that is huge inside of San Marcos.
I remember working late at night, like maybe last call, and it'd be three deep at the bar, and we have all these people in there, we're trying to get served, and Eddie Mack would be sitting at the end of the bar yelling, "Shots! Shots!" You know, and it's like, he wants you to wait on him right now, you know, but I'm trying to like get everybody served before last call's over, you know, but you know, you couldn't ignore Eddie Mack, so you would always have to take care of his shots.
You know, I wouldn't say he never got too close to any of his employees. I think he really did enjoy all of his employees, but he wouldn't, you know, cut them slack. If you fucked up, you got fired. And it didn't mean, you know, I think forever is a word Eddie would never use. He'd fire you and hire you again, you know, later on down the road. He fired my brother. My brother worked there. My brother was great, you know. He would do his job. He was loved by the customers. He'd pull a crowd in, but he couldn't show up on time. And then he was like, "That's it, you're fired. Like, we expect you to be here." So he held people to the expectations that I feel were appropriate. And when they weren't met, you know, it was like, "Dude, you know what's going on." I remember an old employee had told me a story. About when he got fired, and he was messing up, you know, he's drinking on the job, getting drunk, and or showing up late. I can't remember what it was, but he said Eddie Mack pulled him into the office and told him, said, "Hey man, you know, this can't happen. The next time this happens, I'm gonna have to fire you. I've been a long time employee, another great one, you know. He drew a crowd, everyone loved him." And he said, if this happens again, you know, I'm gonna pull you back here, and I'm gonna make you tell me that I told you that this was gonna happen, and then I'm gonna fire you." And I said, "How did it go?" And he says, "Well, it happened again." And Eddie Mack pulled me back into his office, and he asked me, "What did I tell you?" And I told him that you told me if this happened again that you'd fire me. And he said, and we both cried, and he fired me. And I was like, "Shit, man, that's incredible. You know, it sucks." But that's the kind of guy he was, you know. So that's how he was with other employees. I'd say that's how he'd be with any employee. Ruben, I think, probably would have been the most fired, rehired employee. I think, I don't know, maybe. At least that's the way the stories lead to tell. Like I said, I wasn't here. You know, there's a lot of hearsay about what goes on. Ruben and Eddie Mack, I mean, I'd say, and Ruben might not agree with it, but from what I saw and how I understand the relationship, is Eddie Mack was definitely Ruben's big brother. And Ruben looked up to Eddie Mack. You know, he'd want to be right there. Well, I could punch just as hard as Eddie Mack could punch. You know, I'd beat Eddie Mack at pool any day. He was his big brother, for sure. I bet there's a lot of people in this town that are jealous of Reuben and Eddie Mack's relationship. They were pretty close.
Eddie Mack didn't have a whole bunch of people that he could confide in, outside of maybe his brother, you know, and I for some reason, I was that person.
Gosh, Fred and Eddie Mack. I mean, Eddie Mack was Fred's dad. You know, there it is. You know, that Freddie Mack was Freddie Mack. You might as well. That's not the first time that's been said before, Freddie Mack. Fred really looked up to Eddie Mack. Eddie Mack was hilarious, funny, sharp as a tack. I mean, and I knew Fred loved him very much. I mean, that's just a family right there. We're talking about a family here now. With Eddie Mack and his staff.
I could talk to him about anything. He would give me great advice. Sometimes he'd give me shitty advice. You know, just like a dad would do. You can't, you know, expect the most out of somebody, but that's, we spent a lot of time together, you know, and I think he really nurtured me because my dad died when I was 8. You know, when I had a hard decision to make in my life, I would come to him. And he would sit me down and we would talk about it. And it wasn't just like 5 minutes, it's like hours we would talk about it. And he was that kind of guy, and he was that kind of guy to everybody, I think. But for me personally, I have in my heart my memories of him. He helped me out a lot. He really did. He made me think about a lot of things. And he made me rethink a lot of decisions that I would have made differently. And I think he steered me on the right path. And that's kind of what dads are supposed to do, right? So, yeah, in a sense, he was kind of my dad. That's why this has all been so hard for me. Because when I say he's like my dad, I got two great sisters out of this. I got Ashley, I got Cassie. I got a family that I never had before him. I mean, I have a family, but not like that. That's a loving family.
So, I think, you know, the lifestyle that my dad led, it's, he spent most of his adult life in a bar. And it was a bar that didn't outlaw smoking until 2013 or 14, I'm not sure of the exact year. And I think that you're bound to kind of suffer as a result of that. My dad was first, you know, diagnosed with some potential pulmonary issues, I think when we were in high school, but he was able to really make it through those without a lot of challenge. Now my dad, anybody who knew him knows that he was just a stubborn Texan. And his favorite thing to say was, if you lay down, you stay down. My dad was never going to lay down, so he just fought through it. I don't think anybody really knew what his health situation was until about 2015. No.
I feel like New Orleans.
Yeah, that was about 2009, excuse me. About 2009, I think that's when we started to recognize his health status. So he had taken us out to New Orleans for the Saints versus Cowboys. The Saints were undefeated that year until the Cowboys came into the Superdome. And won. But I think through that trip, you know, we would take a few steps down the block and he would have to stop and rest. And we'd take a few more steps and he'd stop and rest. That's when Ashley and I really started to realize that his health was declining, I think faster than we had realized. So kind of through this process, we talked about what his options were. And as many people that are facing kind of end-stage pulmonary disease know, a transplant, a lung transplant, seemed to be his only option. So we lived in Colorado, both of us at the time, and Ashley moved down to Texas. She quit her job, she left her home, she came down to Texas to support him and be that person that he needed to help him through that process of getting listed for transplant.
He's on a list, okay? And they gave him a pager from this transplant hospital in San Antonio. So he says, man, when this thing beeps, I gotta go. And so one day he calls me, his daughters call me and they say, hey, dad got the page, he's going to get lungs. And he did. It was one of the most awesome things in the world for him.
In September of 2011, he'd been listed for only 3 days. And my sister called and she said, you've got to fly down, dad's getting his transplant. So it's pretty remarkable how quickly he got a transplant. I flew down here, he got his transplant, and back to his mantra, if you lay down, you stay down. He was out of the hospital in 6 days, and he was back to work in less than 6 weeks.
This is a bilateral lung transplant, like, in one of the most complicated surgeries the surgeon said he'd ever performed. His lung disease had led to a great deal of scar tissue, and the surgeon said that he had never transplanted in somebody with so much scar tissue, and the surgery lasted, 12 hours?
About 12 hours.
And within 2 days, he was off the ventilator and up and like trying to walk around. Like, it was amazing. And after that, like, he was back to his old self. Like, I mean, he knew the life that he had been given, and he was gonna take full advantage of that. And it was amazing to see somebody go from on oxygen 100% of the time, hardly able to walk even on the oxygen, to his 15 years before self. And he knew exactly the gift that he'd been given. He had no question about it, and just dove back in. Like, that man was gonna live his life, and like, he really did.
My dad's experience inspired me to change careers, and I moved into the world of transplant and organ donation. And I occasionally get to talk about him, which is just a real joy for me to get to share sort of his story and what he went through to get there. And what I like to say is he got about 4 years of life out of the bilateral lung transplant. And in those 4 years, he met my two kids. He got to walk Ashley down the aisle at her wedding. I think he lived more life in those 4 years than he had for the 10 years before. And I continue to be grateful. I know Ashley continues to be grateful. And I know that in those 4 years that he was here, he was ultimately grateful for the gift that he'd been given and the life that he got as a result. I think it's hard on this side of it to think about that experience and to think about everything that he and Ashley and my family and our extended family went through to get him there. But I don't think any of us would ever trade it. I think that the dad that we got in those last 4 years of his life was the dad that we know in our childhood, and the dad that he just wasn't physically able to be for the 10 years before. I still think of that as one of the most pivotal and monumental experiences of my life.
You know, the night that he passed away, I come in here and I just got off work. Fred and Andrew tell me, they said, hey, Ashley and everybody need to see you. Eddie Mack wants to see you. He's not good. I said, well, I need to get gas, you know. So I go get gas at the Yellow store, come back, let's go. And the boys are like, he just passed away. We don't think we ought to go. I said, well, I need to go, so I'll see y'all later. The craziness of that is I'm on my way because he was with Ashley at the house she was living in Martindale, okay, on the river, just basically on the other side of Martindale. And I don't know how to explain this, but on my way, it was a clear night. On my way, I had a rainstorm. It poured down enough on me to make me stop, and I couldn't figure out what was going on. But I knew after a few moments that it was because I was all about me losing my friend. But what I needed to be at that point was Reuben helping Eddie's daughters deal with the loss of their dad. So I needed to be the big brother to them. And so rain checked down and I knew what I had to do. So I had, got my stuff together, got to the house, knocked on the door. And the girl said, we knew it was going to be you. And I said, yeah, I had to be here. You know that. You know, I was going to be here no matter what for you. So I walked in. Eddie's body's still there. we're hanging out. He says, you want a beer? I said, yeah. You know, and sat there rubbing it on his head, kissed him goodbye.
I was here. I saw it happen. It wasn't pretty. But we all fucking trucked on. Kept this place going. It's all you can do.
I think it's hard when you lose somebody, no matter who you are, and like, you know, going through the process of like figuring out like, you know, how to memorialize them and what's gonna happen is, it's hard for everybody, but it's something like, I am extremely grateful for the response that we got when we lost him. You know, of course, like there were hundreds of people that, you know, responded on Facebook and said, like, you know, shared their memories and their pictures. And you know, you can probably go through some of that and for your purposes, but we knew immediately that his service wouldn't be traditional, that it wouldn't be him to go to a funeral home and, you know, have a buttoned-up service, that wasn't going to be him at all. So we knew that we would do it at the bar. He also, you know, had a religious background, and we didn't think that it would be okay for there not to be, you know, a religious person presiding over it.
So, I know y'all know each other pretty well, and I also know it'd be kind of funny to find a pastor in a bar. In fact, there's kind of a joke about that, right? A pastor and a rabbi.
Priest walk on a bar.
So,
we ended up finding the most amazing guy. He's the, I think he was the assistant pastor at the Methodist church just up the street. And he just got it right away, like who Dad was and what the community was. And he, you know, let us make the decisions that we wanted and didn't give us any flack at all. He said, we're going to do what you want to do.
Family. And from the long and winding cheesy jokes that often go nowhere, Eddie Mack was what was up for what was to be enjoyed in life. Eddie Mack also had an edge, and he had strict expectations, but he also had a big heart. Apparently there's a Facebook comment going on that says something to the effect that, like this if you've been fired and then rehired.
And it was the most heartwarming thing I think I've ever experienced. We had, you know, Cassie and I both spoke, and of course that was good, but I think the most amazing part of it, this entire bar was full. I mean, like, people standing outside, every part of this place filled up, and the song that we finished with was what he used to sing at the bar when he would close it down. It was Goodnight, Irene.
Irene, good night. Good night, Irene, good night.
And everybody remembered that about him. And when we put that song on, the entire bar sang along with it. They all sang Irene, good night. And it was so beautiful, and it was such a testament. I couldn't think of a better goodbye. And when does an entire, like, I mean, not even an entire congregation if you have a typical funeral. Like, not everybody sings, but everybody stood up and sang Goodnight, Irene to say goodbye to him, and it was one of the most beautiful things I've ever experienced.
I would say, you know, my experience with that, I've lived in Colorado for some time, since 93, so I've been outside of this community for a while. And I think when we lost my dad, the community rallied around my sister and I, and the way that my dad had rallied around the community. And I never felt like an outsider or that I wasn't welcome. I think they made us feel like we didn't have to worry about any of it. We had people that were setting up, you know, food arrangements to come here. We had people that were donating kegs. We had even our Reverend Todd came from a recommendation from Reuben Brooks, who's known us since we were kids and was always a great helper to my dad. I really felt like the community came together at that time in a way that I never really expected that it could. And I think that the send off to him was just, it was fitting. As we were waiting in the waiting room, as he was in the operating room. And this had been a 9-month journey to get him to transplant. And I talked to my aunt, his sister, I think about every day. And as we were waiting in the waiting room, she said to me, "How does a person sign up to become an organ donor? Is that something that you have to pay for?" And it was really that moment for me that I realized that even those of us that are very close to the process don't always have an understanding of how it works. And it's a misconception to many people about what that means to sign up as a donor, to receive a transplant, to really receive that gift of life and to give that gift of life, to support that gift of life. So it inspired me to really switch gears on my career. I had been working in healthcare and ended up coming to an organ procurement organization, so this the organization that facilitates that process. And every opportunity I can, I like to say there's nobody on a plane that I've sat next to that hasn't learned about organ donation, because any opportunity I can, I like to talk to people about the significance of that gift and what an impact it can have, to help people understand what that means, what it means as a process, but more importantly, what it means to people like my dad and families like my dad. So I've really kind of made it my mission to make sure that people understand that.
I mean, I've just been trying to get along. I think, the biggest change for me is I never thought I wanted to have kids. It's something I had no interest in whatsoever. But after losing Dad, like, I knew, like, if you want to have a family, you have to create your own family. And I couldn't bear for that bond to die out. So I decided to do it. And I have a little girl now. Her name is Marley Mack, named after Eddie Mack, her grandpa. And I think that's been the biggest decision that I made after losing him, is that I wanted his legacy to continue on, and I wanted to be able to pass on what he taught me to another generation. And she hears about it all the time. You know, she's a Sam Martian, so she hears all the time about who her Papa Mac was and what he was all about, and you know, the lessons that he taught me, I pass on to her.
I tell him I love him. I love him, you know, and I tell him I missed him, because I love my friends, and he's one of my best friends. I miss him. I miss the camaraderie we had between us, and I miss his crustiness. I just miss him, you know.
I'd ask him how he thought I was doing, and if he was happy with the way things are going. It's a huge undertaking. It's not just running a bar, it's also maintaining a community. And I feel pretty good about what I'm doing. I think he would be happy, but definitely if he was here, if I could have his attention, I'd be curious as to what he thought, and I'd hope he'd be happy about it. That's if Eddie Mack was right there. That's what I'd probably ask him first. How are you doing? You know, is everything good? Because I know you've been watching it. You know, is everything good? You know, do you have any thoughts? You know, are we doing okay? What do you think? Are you happy?
It's different. All of this is different. But I'm willing to give it another shot because I love this place that much. I spent almost 10 years of my life in this place. And I love it. And coming back into here was kind of like settling into a warm bath. It's like you know you're supposed to be here. You know what I mean? So we'll see how it goes. I don't know. Nervous, excited, mortified, sad. I feel all the feelings. But I'm back. That's all that matters, I guess.
Your mother for you. She told me that you were too young. I wish, dear Lord, that I never seen your face. I'm sorry you ever was born. Irene, good night. Sometimes I live in town. Sometimes I have the great notion to jump into the river and drown. Irene, good night. Irene, good night. Good night, Irene, good night, Irene, I get you in my dream. Stop rambling,